It's like, I think a lot of record labels can't really see ahead, you know. It's like,
and you don't...
It's like people, somebody was saying to me the other day, like, are you going to do a dance remix, you know, like all the other groups are doing dance remixes, you know. I mean, to me, a dance remix is like 2 years out of date already. I mean, we did it like with Hit the Nose, like about 5-7 years ago, you know. And trying to explain that to a record label is really hard. I mean, drums and bass is out now. I mean, it's like, it's just a phase, isn't it? I mean, if you know what you want to do, you just carry on straight down the middle, don't you? I find it goes around in the 7-year cycles, I think. I wouldn't have said that to you about 4 or 5 years ago, but I do actually feel very much like I did when I started the group, you know, at the moment.
And do you have the same kind of fans now as you did then? Or?
Still very much. I think we're more outside now than we were when we started. Well, as much as when we started.
Ask you this question though, because we're in the 1990s and this is the era of the Fall as we know, where former members come back into the band and also original members leave the band. So I gotta ask you this question: if you were a member of the Fall and old Marky Smith gave you a little ring, or maybe you just see him at the pub, you know, bump into him. And, you know, it's after a couple of pints, the question's raised, what, you know, why don't you come back? Maybe not in a nice way, but what are you going to say, you know, in the position? You're a former member of the band and you got the opportunity to join the Fall. And let's just say it's in the same era, like, you know, early 90s. To come back into the band.
Yeah, I mean, I gotta find out what the day rate is first, see how things have progressed.
The stipend has gone up. Uh-huh. The weekly stipend's gone up or down?
Yeah,
that's a good question. What else do you need to know about this to make a good informed decision?
I gotta ensure I get some drink tickets for the performances. I'm not paying for them myself. I'm in this weekly stipend. I need Mark doesn't get them all.
You want your own champagne bottle?
I want a guaranteed glass of the champagne.
One glass before the bottle is evacuated from the building. Okay, that's good.
Yeah, that's good. And then I think I'm in to join the circus again. I mean,
you are? You're down for it?
Yeah, I mean, worst case scenario, like,
you know what it is. You've been through it. You know, like, you know.
Yeah.
You know what that is.
I mean, I think then it's just a circus. And then if things go sideways, I think I'm trying to take the ship down this time. I'm not just gonna go.
You're gonna sabotage it yourself.
Yeah, I'm not gonna go peacefully the night if things are getting quit. And I'm gonna start, you know, trying to pull people off. I might start my own, you know, anonymous projects with fake names and bring in some band members around.
It does fit. It does fit the MO.
I mean, I'd give it a go. See what a live performance is like.
Yeah. But I don't know. It's tough. It's so tough.
I don't think I would be overly. I think I could do it far enough away that, like, far enough, like, emotionally removed that I could just, like, okay, yeah, I'll give it a try. And then if it didn't work out, I could just mosey my way out of there without.
Wait, are you saying you'd be fine because you've had some time to cope with what you experienced the first time, or are you saying you would be able to, like, you know, separate the
mentally, I could understand this is never going to be a cooperative project. This is going to be one thing, and it, once the fun runs out for me, you just kind of step away and you're done with it.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, this is a question I'd love to ask, like, a Steve Hanley. That's, you know, it's interesting because there's the members that came back. We know, you know, multiple members came back into the band, but then there's the members that are like Mark Riley, who basically said it was the best decision ever to to quit being in the Fall, and he never really, as far as we know, looked back on the decision, which is interesting as well. So, because I can see it both ways, and it, for me, it would depend on, am I in my mid-20s? Then yeah, for sure. If I'm in my mid-20s, I mean, honestly, if I'm in my 20s at all, and I have an opportunity to make my living as a musician, and even to, you know, ingest the trauma of being in a negative emotional, a lot of the times working condition band for a third to two thirds of the year, I'm probably going to do that. But if I'm older than that, if I'm a little wiser, if I've had time away from the band, and I am actually still trying to be artistic and moving on with, like, maybe sounds that I wanted to explore that are not Fall adjacent sounds, I think that makes the decision kind of easy too in that regard.
You know? Yeah, but I don't think very many of these people went into that camp of doing their own thing. I feel like they all went into being 30 something year old people, like, working down at their dad's sausage shop, and they were like, wow, this life sucks. Like, I'd much rather be on the road.
Yeah, you think so?
I don't know. I mean, say you were the Hanley brothers, and you've done this for 15 years, and now you're kind of you don't have too many skills outside of music.
That's what I'm saying. I feel like they took a break. They took a break, you know. Took a break, reassessed, probably work at the pie shop, drive the container truck. It doesn't matter, but you're always going to have that, and start another band. A lot of them started other bands, projects, bands that recorded or didn't record or just played live. Like, there's so many that we know of and that we don't know of, but them, they can't stop being musicians, right? Like,
no,
you put it down, you're going to put it down for a while, but you're going to come back to it. But if you, let's say you start a side project that is semi-serious, like, you're just like, oh, I'm doing this because this is the sound I want to go for. This is artistically, creatively fulfilling. And you do that for a while, but you don't get any sort of recognition that is even close to even like the most minute amount of recognition that the Fall gets.
Well, and you also don't probably get any money, even if
that's the trade-off, you know. You had a working machine, you know, you're a part of the working machine. I don't know, it's so tough because you're getting something else out of it, you know. You're playing your own thing, but then you're also like, man, but I'm used to playing for at least on a bad night, it's 150 people in the club. You know, on a good night, it's, you know, it's packed. Yeah. So, but I know the Fall even had off nights where they were on a tour and they got like off, like, even in Scotland, there's people that said, oh, even if like they came to Edinburgh one day, like it was 150 people, then the next day it was like packed, sold out show. It's just like hit or miss. So even then, your whole life is kind of up and down like that. So it's like, do you want to ride that roller coaster? If the music's good, I think that's what it comes down to, right? If the music you're playing is good.
That was the nicest thing about being a Fall member, is it was kind of your creative opportunity. I mean,
yeah,
you kind of got to make your part. To some degree. Right. So you had the creativity, and
you did, you're right.
And then you probably I mean, you're not getting better lyrics out of anybody else. Like, you're not playing in a random, random pub band and getting somebody that's written a song that is interesting.
You're right. Even the worst lyrics out of Marky Smith are going to be head and shoulders above any average musician, lyricist that you're going to come across. So I mean, you're right. Yeah.
It'd be even pretty intimidating to go it your own way and be like, okay, I'm going to do this myself. And like, I'm going to write my own songs. And
for sure.
Like, you're going to be tearing up a lot of pieces of paper looking
for
at
sure. For sure. I know the guys that, like, you know, when they, what I've heard is when they stormed off stage in the 90s in New York City, the fall. And they walked off stage and they're like, we just wanted to start something new after that point. And they started something new. They're like, oh, what? They had all like the second guessing themselves, which is like totally natural thing for any person. They're in a band that's like well regarded. And then to second guess, like, man, did I really make the wise choice? Because you start thinking about all the good times or the good albums or the critical acclaim or touring whatever country you had the most fun in. You're going to think about that stuff. But here we are.
Here we are. You come back. I mean, it seems like he's manipulative, right? So he knows what he's doing. He knows how to invite somebody back to make it look worthwhile, right? Oh, yeah, we could really use you. This is going to be good for us.
Yeah.
Come back into the fold. It'll be great.
It's kind of funny how it seems like he was able to ask people to come back, or they thought that almost it was their idea to come back, which it might have been the case. But at the same time, he also makes it kind of known that they are also filling a hole that was left from, you know, in the lineup that was left because he decided that wasn't the right person before them, right? So it's like kind of like you're jumping into a position that is automatically has already been scorched, and you're just like, oh, I got this place to, you know, explore now, but it's all kind of burnt up, and there's like human residue here of where a person was fulfilling this position, and now it's totally, that's mine to, you know, take advantage of, but there's like kind of like a stench left over where you're like, oh
yeah,
you're not going in there fresh.
Well, yeah, or are you, or are you not? Are you expected to to fill the space, or do you gonna get to, you know, remodel the space? Is it gonna be your own, or is it?
Yeah.
Are you basically just a place filler for the next? Until the next inferno happens.
The good thing about the fall is they move so quickly that the relearning or learning the parts that someone else made is only short term, right? You learn the songs and then you're like, oh, we moved on from those songs. Now they're my songs, which is cool. That is the great part.
Well, they're Mark's songs. You may or may not get credit.
Okay, so let's get into it. We got 1990 singles. We got a bunch to get through. We're kind of having fun already. And some of these singles are exceptionally fun. And some of these singles are just like, let's get into them and see if we can find the little nugget in there that is the salient piece that we can take away as a positive note. Where are we starting with, Steve? We got four singles today. And for side A, we're going to do a couple here. What are we going to start with from in 1990 from the fall?
Yeah, January 15th, 1990, fresh into the new year, we have Telephone Thing. 7-inch, also a 12-inch.
As usual, got the CD.
Basically, you got really two tracks. got Telephone Thing, the extended version, British People in Hot Weather, then there's a telephone dub. From what I'm seeing, it's mostly side A is Telephone Thing extended mix.
Yeah,
and then B side we have British People in Hot Weather and Telephone Dub. So
let's give a listen to it. And as we are, because we got a lot to get through today, but we're going to enjoy it. we're going to be listening to a lot of the extended 12-inch versions that have the extra tracks. So we might be, you know, jumping around a little bit order-wise as far as the tracks, but mostly we're just rolling through 1990 singles. And let's get back into the shop and let's listen to Telephone Thing.
Yeah, we have Marky Smith, Craig Scanlon, Martin Brahma, Steve Hanley, Marcia Schofield, Cy Wollstonecraft. And then we have some special guests on these. Cold Cut is the producer and has some credits on these tracks.
Ooh, we got Cold Cut showing. Matt in our Patreons will be very familiar with the Cold Cut if you are on our Patreon, because we did a little Cold Cut side journey with Marky Smith. And Cold Cut is Matt Black and Jonathan Moore.
Yeah. Basically, they get credits on the extended versions of the songs.
Yeah, like remix extended. Yeah. And okay, let's get into Telephone Thing. Okay, let's just talk about Telephone Thing. Or you want to listen to it?
Yep, I've listened to it.
Yeah, me too. Okay.
You like your Telephone Thing listening in?
We know that Mark loves a good phone tapping theme and a good phone tapping song. And this is actually also a toe tapping song. But musically, I like what's going on. In any other band that wasn't The Fall doing this song, and actually I'm interested, are there any Telephone Thing by The Fall covers? Like, are there covers of the song? Because I'm pretty sure The Fall are the only people that can make this song sound remotely interesting like this. The grittiness, the griminess of it is what makes it cool and re-listenable. But besides that, this is one of my least favorites, to be honest. And I know some people really like this one. What do you feel about the Telephone Thing? Because we got to listen to the dub mix too.
It's an offshoot from what you expect with them. I mean, it's got a dance beat. It's some funk in it.
That's the new stuff. I like that.
Yeah, the noise. What's the
ding 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 ding? You know, like the ting ting to ting to ting. Almost like banging on a bottle with some little ting, 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 ting.
I feel like it's got to just be a synth making the noise, but...
Ta-ta-ta-ting. It is like a loop. The synth work is great. It's cool. And also, Steve Hanley, his bass playing kind of fits a drum and bass dance house music style song.
I was going to say it works
unexpectedly.
It works surprisingly well.
Yeah. I wish the lyrics were a little bit more going somewhere story wise or even just more.
Yeah, I don't know. Without everything else that's going on, I feel like it would just be a mess.
Yeah.
Do you know who Gretchen Franklin is?
No, who's Gretchen Franklin?
He mentions her a couple different times.
Yeah.
It's an actress that
nosy matron
that played in a show called EastEnders, popular show.
I have heard of EastEnders, but I didn't know she's in there. Okay.
In typical Mark fashion, he claims he made up that name and then later.
Oh, totally. Yeah,
later he totally found did. Out later found out he threw his hands in his head. He was so upset with himself.
Oh no, he totally made that up. That person, I mean, that it was probably a different.
Different. It's a different Gretchen Franklin.
I mean, that's kind of a common name when you think about it. Gretchen Franklin. Come on, that could be. There's got to be at least multiple Gretchen Franklins in the world, and Mark knows a couple of them. So that's kind of fun.
It was a different one, not even that.
So the writing credits on this first track are starting off with the Smith Black Moor, which is a new writing combo that we haven't experienced, which is the Cold Cut Boys and Marquis Smith making this song, which is not surprising with how dancey it is, electronic it is. It's cool. Yeah.
I'm happy Mark didn't try to do it himself, just start adding noises, but they make it cool. Dancing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's cool. It's interesting. It's literally my least favorite of 1990 singles songs, but actually if I want our fall heads, if you like Telephone Thing, please let me know what you're digging on this song, because I can get my perspective altered, and I actually like to, if it's stated positively, which I mean, everyone does, and I appreciate. So that's great. So Steve, should we look at the album?
Look
art?
At the album art. Yeah.
Yeah, I really do. I really do want to look at this album art.
Yeah, because, some of these new singles, I think some of the album art is the most enticing part of them.
Yes. And so on the Fall Telephone Thing album art, it is once again made by the same artist as Extricate, and it is Anthony Frost once again. And honestly, this one on this single cover is my favorite. I like the Extricate album art, but actually I like this more. I like the angularness of this. It almost has like a 3D room. I almost feel like I'm in a room.
Yeah,
there's like a tent or something.
A tent. Oh, I see like a super like abstract man lying on the ground, like blue box body, black head, then some legs. He's kind of in the fetal position.
Oh, that's fun. Also, yeah. the cubes in the back, it reminds me of those glass privacy cubes that are usually on like the bathrooms.
A window, yeah, bathroom window or something. Basement window or something.
Basement windows, yep. Really cool. I like it. I like everything about this. Now let's flip it over to the back. Unfortunately, but I will say very tastefully, having all black and then basically that cube little window we were talking about on the front, it is actually that now I'm looking at both of them side by side, it is the same.
Yeah,
it is
for sure.
It is the same from the front.
So it was one piece, or is it two pieces and he just let them lay the second one on the front?
You know what, that's a really good question, because on the Extricate album, we were talking about how it looked kind of like cardboard collage, painted cardboard. And I could easily see that was just laid on another piece as a combination.
They liked them both. They couldn't decide. And Anthony was gracious enough to say, yeah, just slap it on there.
Yeah. And a good placement, I would say, too. Because it doesn't.
The color scheme is cool, muted pastels almost. Yeah, it's in my style for sure.
Totally. I like it a lot. I believe you can actually, I'm looking up right now, you can go get yourself some Anthony Frost original artworks up through, let's see what the most recent one is, about 2012 I'm seeing here.
Yeah, I think he's only 73, so.
Yeah. Pretty cool. Some good stuff. Lots of very colorful artworks that are in line with what we see here, but also much more. He goes to a simpler style, which is interesting too. So cool. Go check out Anthony Frost artworks in general. I know we got a bunch of visual artist podcast heads out there, so you guys already are familiar with this artwork, but go check it out. Let us know what you think about that, if it's your deal or whatever. Let's go on to the side B. Steve, what do we got on side B of telephone thing?
I mean, we just have a good old this funny song. British people in hot weather.
I mean, it's summertime. I'm sitting outside right now. It's still 91 degrees in Austin, Texas, and I am ready to get sweaty.
Are you gonna tolerate it, or is your ancestral roots coming out of you? You're not full Austinite yet.
No. I'm used to it. That's why I'm sitting out here right now. I could be inside in the air conditioning. I actually enjoy it now. I actually relish it. It's like the pain of the game. You gotta pay the toll to appreciate the good times that I have when the whole rest of the year when the sun is out. I do miss those Chicago gray days. You still appreciate those?
Yeah. I'm a seasonal guy. I like to have four seasons, but I like the summertime. I like to be hot. It doesn't bother me.
Yeah, you do. You like to cruise around when it's hot out. You like to go to the lakefront. Throw the fishing pole in there.
Yeah, it was 90 degrees day. I was running around cutting the grass. It was good.
Yeah. It makes you feel like you're in the nature. That's why the thing is, California is beautiful. We're gonna turn into California bashing podcast too. It's the spirit of Mark in us. But California, obviously, it's beautiful. Obviously, it's got a lot going on. It's so nice. But after a while, it's like, what? Don't you want to feel Mother Nature's strength and humility on you? You know, don't you want to feel?
I mean, I think it's always funny too. All the LA people have like every month has a different like saying, like, oh, it's the June gloom, it's all smoggy, it's a terrible month to be here. And you're just like, it's pretty much the same. Like,
yeah, it is. Yeah. And honestly, I like gray winter Chicago skies over smog, please. Please, I don't want smog. I don't want to see smog. That's just like that's a literally extra depressing state. Because that's human made atmospheric environment that I don't want to experience that.
Yeah. I mean, how do you tolerate? Like, I feel born and raised in Chicago, like the holidays are pretty tied to the seasons for me. And I've traveled a little bit like around Christmas time. Like we were in like Columbia one year and it's hot and like weird. And like there's Christmas trees up and like, you're just like, this doesn't feel like it should.
Yeah. I still like walking around in Austin when it's Christmas and it's 74. 60, 70, yeah. It's like as high as 74 and you're seeing all these Christmas lights on ranch style homes and they're glistening off of the grass and like it's in cactuses. And
yeah. You still have to water your grass.
No, I just let it die and then it'll come back maybe. But yeah, though, but that's what it, I, I've come to appreciate that as that's a different type of holiday now. It's a totally different feel, where instead of being cozy and warm and inside, you're like, let's go outside. Let's go around town. Let's go on the trail.
Yeah, you should, right? This is when we're able to.
Yeah, this is actually what it is.
Yeah, I've been to visit you in multiple different seasons now, and yes, the summer is pretty oppressive. When you catch
days. I feel like the thing is too, it makes it even worse, is if you come here when you haven't. Like, as I get to slowly acclimate myself, it's kind of like, I mean, it's not that slow, but over, 3 weeks, it's a slow ramp up usually. And for unaccustomed folk,
well, especially you come right into it and then you're on vacation and you're trying to run around and do all of the things all at once. And you're like, you're not like necessarily, yeah, it's 1 o'clock. I should probably be chilling somewhere. You're like, oh, gotta get out there and get a hike in or go walk around.
I should probably be relaxing in air conditioning, but now I am dead.
Yeah, all I've eaten is breakfast tacos all day from the gas station, and they were really good.
Fatty meat in my system that I'm sweating out immediately.
from the roadside stand that is just basically, they have no, it's all outdoor seating, and they have a fan that just blows road dirt into your face, and you're like, oh, this is so relaxing.
Hey, that's one of the best brisket spots. Don't talk shit about that place. But what is the I want to know though, because actually I kind of know from talking to people, but what is this song? What is the song? What is going on here? But also, really, when it gets warm out in the UK, what are British people doing that one day of the year? what is going on? And I'm seriously interested in knowing what, are you going to the park? You having a picnic? Are you, what is the real British person in hot weather doing? I mean, are you just sitting in the pub?
Have you ever seen that? Have you seen that viral photo though of the British guy with his pants around his ankles drinking a beer?
No. I haven't, but I was thinking of a different one, which is the meme, which is like the British man on the one day of summer of a year, and it's like his back. He has his shirt off, and it's like super sunburned, and he has a huge long scripture that's like a Bible. A biblical scripture tattooed into his back. Maybe we'll post both of these for this episode. So,
yeah, but this
do you like the song though? You like that?
I mean, it's silly. I don't think it's anything.
It reminds me of Australians in Europe, where it's something that Mark is going for that I just don't know what I don't know what it is, but it's funny.
Yeah,
it's fun.
It's good to me, and it's a perfect B-side for a single. I'm glad
it's perfect B-side. It's like kind of a funny one-off, and the synth horns are hysterically bad. I want to know what was going through the band's mindset at this point, where they were obviously friends with Cold Cut, and they just attempted to make, which is fun, which I actually give them props for going for it, make dance like dance music. Like, what were they thinking?
Yeah, I mean, they don't have credits on this one, so I don't know if this was inspired by them or this was the whole idea in general. They were like, oh, if we're working together, we'll bring something, you bring something, we'll see where we end up.
Oh, maybe actually that does make sense that they did the telephone thing. They did telephone extended mix. And then they also have the telephone thing dub version, which we're about to listen to. Maybe they had all of those going on and they said, what goes with that? And this one was just like, totally. This one,
that's what I mean. Yeah, goes just, with it. Yeah. They're just having, well, or they didn't even have it. Or yeah, maybe they had this, Mark had the lyrics and they were like, yeah, let's turn those lyrics into this thing.
Yeah, I feel like they had this one just like chill, like in their back pocket. And they were like, this one definitely fits the vibe of that's going on here with the dance club mixes. And all right, let's listen to it. Let's go out on the telephone dub.
Dub.
So actually on the meme, it is this guy has a back tattoo looking pretty red. And it says on the sixth day, God created man, Chester. And when I, and when Steve, when you and I go to Manchester and do our fall pilgrimage, we're both going to have to get this tattoo somewhere on our bodies. Hate to do it to you.
That's fine.
Fall always, Patreons have.
We've always wanted a tattoo. Just never committed. So here I am.
Here you are. And now you have a tattoo that is referencing Manchester, which is
my second home at this point.
Second home. Yep.
Never been, but I'll be there one day.
Yeah. You hearing anything different in this dub version?
I mean, it sounds more dubby for sure. I'm definitely it does sound dubby. Dubbed sounds, out.
Yeah. It actually has a more tranquil, kind of cool, serene.
Yeah, it's way more subdued. Yeah, it kind of drone. It's drony enough that you mind less that the lyrics aren't there.
When I was listening to this one, this version, I was kind of hoping. Or actually, I was kind of thinking it would be cool to have some sort of ambient track, because even though this is not ambient, it's got a dub beat, a track where Marky Smith is doing reverbed out vocals, but it's an ambient track. I don't know if that exists, but I hope that we come across it. Can you picture that?
Yeah. I mean,
in your ear?
He does so little with his lyrics. It's hard to imagine it. I don't know.
If you could think of his voice, I mean, his voice is not very ethereal, but if you can think about a way, like it, his voice mixed into an ambient, very chill soundscape, and just hear him, it would have to be one of his whispering type deliveries where he's, you know, kind of, you know, whispering in your ear almost. Yeah.
Keeping the microwave away from his tonsils, the microphone.
let's jump forward to.
Yeah, you ready? You ready? Yeah. You got your new single?
Yeah. We just picked up, we went back down to the shop because honestly, we felt kind of ripped off on that first one. Or at least I did. So I want to get another fall single, and it's only 3 months later. We're on March 12th, 1990, and Cock Sinister has released, thankfully, another single for us. And we're going to go through a handful of tracks. And the first one we are definitely familiar with, right?
Yeah, we got the Popcorn Double Feature.
We got a nice cover to start it off. So let's listen to Popcorn Double Feature.
Everybody's going through changes. Everybody's got
moving on. We got Popcorn Double Feature, which we are definitely familiar with. And has anything come to light to you on this song? Sound-wise?
No. I mean, it's dark and brooding for being such a poppy little ditty. I mean,
yeah,
Popcorn Double Feature. But, I mean, he's singing dark and...
It does have a great melodic chorus, and you can, if you didn't know already, The Fall did not write that. That is, this is definitely an English and Weiss co-written track, and I really like the synth on this track, but whenever I hear this, it's just so sad, and not in a cool way. In a Mark sounds sad as hell. I just can't get past that.
Yeah, that's what I get. It's almost depressing to listen to the lighthearted nature of it and be...
And do you think he's really going for that? Like, because it almost sounds so naturally depressed.
I don't know. Like it is. I mean, I don't know. Like, he doesn't... Anytime else he does a cover, he's basically trying to match the...
Yeah, he is. You're right.
So maybe he was just truly in a funk and he couldn't bring himself out of it, but
yeah. And the last track we should say on the single is also a cover, which is Black Monk Theme Number 2, Part 2, which is another version of the Monk's classic. And he's trying to sing like the Monk's, which is
I'm not finding that anywhere. I mean, you go on to fall.org and you're seeing 5 tracks, but every 12-inch I see only has 3 songs on
it. Well, here's the thing. The Black Monk Theme Part 2, it says it's only on the limited edition 12-inch. And the limited edition 12-inch does not have Arms Control Poser. It has Black Monk Theme Part 2, which is interesting swap.
And I'm not seeing Xandra anywhere. I only see the 3 songs. Popcorn Double Feature, Number 2, Arms Control Poser, and Butterflies for Brains.
See, I got you there, too. Because Xandra is only on the limited edition 7-inch and the limited edition 12-inch. So here's the thing. If you want those couple songs, you got to get you got to get all these limited edition. But is this the first time where they had limited edition? They had Ghost in My House, but that was more of a hologram variant cover. That wasn't like you're getting different tracks.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird how very the song, interesting. Even on the CD, there's only 3 songs, which usually the CD or the tape, you're getting anything and everything that you could imagine.
Yeah. Weird. Yeah. Well, if you want the Searchers cover, Popcorn Double Feature, you got to get one of those limited editions, which apparently were only 3,000 copies each. So I bet you that's going to be kind of pricey. Steve, let's go right into a track that we've actually heard before.
I think we should go into a different track.
Okay, let's go into a different track.
I think we should go into the number 2 track everywhere I'm seeing, which is Arms Control Poser. And
okay, fine. That's fine by me. I like listening to the Arms Control Poser. Let's give it a roll.
I want to feel the way Mark felt out the songs.
Yeah.
But I do love Butterflies for Brains. I wish it was a diss track, because it's a great... I mean, that's just a great way to just...
See, I liked the original Butterflies for Brains version, too, and You know, I'm glad that it got a second chance, even though I think the first version was way better. Actually,
Whiz Bang?
Yeah. I like the thrown offness of Whiz Bang. Like almost like it's a toss off track, but it's actually very catchy, guitar wise. And I'm glad they did something with it. And in Mark fashion, he does something that's very cutting with that. But what about Arms Control Poser?
In the opposite way of Popcorn Double Feature, I like the darkness of it. The deep bass, deep guitar, little guitar shredding in the background is always a
yes.
fun that you don't typically get. I mean, it's way yep. back there, but it's still there.
I know. Why is it so far back there? Mark thought it was too much of a guitar solo. Because I like that. I mean, it's really... It's not a guitar solo. It's really...
It's like blues. It's like blues guitar kind of in the... I mean,
it's kind of like an abstract blues, you're right. Like abstract angular blues guitar. Because it kind of has some screechiness to it, which I really like. The only thing, what I hate to do it to him, but Steve Hanley's bass is just the one thing. I like the tone of the bass, I like the rhythmic nature of it.
I think it's just a little bit like too fat. Like you're just letting the guitar, the strings just bong. Like it's just too much coming out of them.
Yeah. Don't. It's almost like too predictable. Like you want something that's a little bit more, makes you listen to it hard.
Yeah. And it's truly just,
you never have to again after you hear it, like
an
the first
up and
minute.
Down, an up and down, up and down, up and down.
Yeah.
Up and down.
Dun, dun, dun. Dun, 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 dun. It's almost kind of like, yeah, I just, it's not my favorite part of this track.
This is when I try to learn bass guitar, I'll learn this one first.
Oh, I think that's a great call. Great call. What about some of these lyrics? Because I do know this is coming from, I guess, a headline that Mark read, the title, because the rest of it is not all in line with the story.
Yeah, I mean, obviously they're singles, but yeah, you're getting you're getting a good story. You got some dates and times and people, and yeah, I mean.
And what my favorite is actually when he kind of goes off a little bit from the Arms Control theme, or so it seems, where he starts going sports car interior, encrusted with blue bottles, armored car interior, encrusted with blue bottles. I even stop to an icy vodka as I feel the inevitable battle creep nearer and nearer. Chip, chip. Chip, chip.
Yeah,
but,
right.
But isn't that fun to have like interior of different vehicles that are totally unrelated and icy blue? What is it? Blue bottles, which I just assume is the vodka bottles, right?
Yeah, right. It's gotta be, right? Yeah.
It's gotta be.
So I drink and recline with an acquaintance sound.
Yeah, that's, yeah. I like that. But it takes you out of like, no, it's great. It's great. Arms control guy that's selling some weapons, but then it goes into like his own vices. Cool. Great.
Yeah, you gotta get into it. his armored car interior, sports car interior. I mean, he's got both for sure.
He's got both. It's almost like he's jumping from one to the other, and they both have like the little, you know, he's gonna have his little nip of his vodka shot when he's going doing the deals, or if he's delivering the deals, or if he's delivering the goods. He's going to be ready. He's going to be lubricated, loosened up.
Yeah, I mean, we forgot. We didn't even mention the weather. I mean, this whole episode's about the weather. Give me a nice woolly polo neck with a red cardigan from Next. Ideal summer wear.
Yeah, I'm not really picturing him wearing that, but yes, I mean, I do like that. What do you seek? Oblivion. That's great, too. I just like, Where do you seek oblivion and drugs off the streets? Oh man, come on. That's a good song. That's a good song. Okay, Steve, what do we got next? Or oh, actually, should we look at? Oh, no, we actually we gotta let's look at the track.
Look at some album art here.
Yeah, let's look at the album art.
We've got our good friend Anthony Frost.
Yeah, but I here. Think he got done. I think he got done dirty a little bit on this one.
You think so? You think they chopped it in half on him or what?
I don't like how the band's name is centered. I don't like how straight this is.
Huh.
You know? I just don't like that how straight it is, how straightforward it is, because on the last one it was so good. Things are offset to the left and right. Even on the back it's offset. And this just looks a little bit too standard. Even though I like what's going on in the art. I like the color scheme.
I was
going
to say, I like the color scheme. I like the font a lot. I like that point, big pointy A they got. The bubble letters is good for popcorn.
The letters are kind of like a popcorn bag text. Yeah. I could see some of that too. Flip it over. What is that?
I'd buy it. I mean, I think it's the same from the front, is it not? Yeah, it's the same line from the front that's transferred to the back, just like last time.
Yeah, but how do you like the popcorn kernel?
Oh, I don't know. Which limited edition are you looking at?
Here, check this out.
Yeah. That's not on the back. That is alternate. That is an alternate.
The popcorn
single.
Kernel.
Yeah.
Okay, so y'all, this is
that is the 12-inch 45 limited edition.
Limited edition. Okay, so the
limited edition has a big
popcorn kernel on it. A massive popcorn kernel that's so zoomed in that it almost looks grotesque. Like human ear.
Check out the back side of that special edition. Mm-hmm. It's just a bunch of popcorn kernels, also pretty zoomed in, but not. That's the one with Xandra on it and Black Monk theme on the backside. That's special.
That's kind of, that's kind of lame.
I'm not buying that one for sure.
I'm actually going to say that's pretty lame. They almost downgraded by 90 to 95% cool factor from Anthony Frost artwork to an image of popcorn kernels zoomed in photographs.
Double popcorn kernel. Yeah, I mean,
pretty bad decision on that. That's guys.
Only,
that is
only,
oh
only,
my god!
But only 3,000 of them were created. It's not even that many.
I'm glad that Anthony Frost's artwork is on the basically original version that is readily accessible, but also at the same time I'm like, man, Anthony Frost deserves even another variant of his artwork just to keep it going, man. Okay, well that pretty much sucks. So what are we gonna listen to next, Steve?
We're gonna go into Xandra.
Okay, let's listen to Xandra.
Old Whiz Bang Butterfly for Brains. I mean, I like that one. That's just
just definitely listen to that one.
I liked it
musically. I like almost all of these tracks of 1990 singles a lot. I think the band was really doing something that was like so catchy, but at the same time exploring dark tones, exploring super hooky guitar riffs. the keyboards are so good. They got organ, synth, you know, even bad synth sounds. But I just really like the musicality of the 1990 fall.
Yeah, it seems like they're having fun. They're experimenting, getting out there still, which is, I mean, what you want.
As much as I think that Mark sounds kind of tired on some tracks in 1990, the band doesn't sound tired.
Oh, no. Yeah, I mean, they're all...
It's like a fresh air, like a breath of fresh air came into the band via Martin or just... You know, just
yeah,
the
we need Bricks combination. Marsha's getting a little bit more liberties. I don't know.
Marsha's doing great. I mean, I love Marsha's every touch on the keyboard. So good. Also, so many different sounds, which I also appreciate because it's so easy to fall into the, I mean, even look at the original, I mean, they didn't have that many options, but the original fall keyboard sound, the Una sound, is a great sound, but it's so easy to fall into one sound and be like, that's our sound, that's our sound, let's use that for everything because that's our signature sound. But Marsha, come on, she is going off.
Yeah, I mean, it's, I mean, it's so frequently it's very forward facing too, right? Where it's not buried in the background. I mean, I feel like Una got that quite a bit where
it is, and that actually brings up a good point. Let's talk about the producer. Craig Leon is producing these tracks, and also, of course, Marky Smith is producing as well. Not to, you know, cut him short, but yeah.
I mean, who else? Adrian Sherwood too.
Sherwood too. Yes.
Yeah.
And they're getting great sounds, and whoever mixed this does, for the most part, a good job of getting that band sound. We always want the guitars more forward, just for future note. For future reference for those mixing and remastering fall albums. Get those fucking guitars up there. I'm not going to ask again.
Sandra!
What about Sandra?
Not who's sure who Sandra is. She sounds interesting.
Well, it is written by Mr. Beddington. It is written by a Mr. Beddington alongside Marky Smith. So... I can hear a Martin Brahma influence on that track, but
yeah,
I'm going to give it to Marsha.
That's kind of a Marsha showcase. The keys for sure drive it. And then, you know, Martin's going to write about it. Want to write a song about a girl.
Sandra, yeah, hot babe.
Some sort of hot babe. It doesn't seem like it's really a particular hot babe, but.
No, it doesn't. But we gotta also take into account that it's Mark writing these lyrics.
Everybody right? You love is covered in loot. Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like you said,
so give up that dope shit.
The synth carries the song all day long.
Yeah. This is a good one to put on like on Sunday morning, I feel like.
When you're getting ready to clean the house a little bit.
Yeah. Or destroy the house.
Oh. Sunday fun day, here we come. You're popping that bottle of champagne that you didn't get into in the green room.
No, I haven't slept in 3 days. I'm on that Marky Smith yellow speed. I haven't slept in 3 days since Friday night show. So it's Sunday morning. I'm like, let's get something going here. Put on that Xandra.
Yeah.
Put on that 12-inch limited edition Xandra. Put it on
that,
repeat.
It's not your oyster. Give you that dope shit.
Yeah, give me that dope shit. Give up that dope shit. And should we move on? What is the last option?
The last option is Black Theme Monk Part 2.
Yeah, let's listen to this version of Black Theme or Black Monk Theme and the second version and give this a go and see how it differs or varies from the original.
I mean, this will go well with your speed hangover, where you can't really stop your leg from shaking, and
this is gonna make me claw the fucking walls off, like the drywall off of the studs. That background, that arpeggiator that's turned up to maximum is too much. It's like chipmunk.
And I mean, yeah, exactly. It just feels like they're like, yeah, try it at 1.5 speed and we'll see where we're at.
Let's slow this down. It's basically a remix because it's basically Mark's same vocal performance. But I don't know why Mark thought he could sing this song. Like, you did you listen to the original? I mean you've listened to the original, right? That dude is fucking singing the fuck out of the song. Like, his vocal performance is unbelievably almost like a transfixed gospel singer. He is like belting out this thing and hitting so many notes, and Mark's like, oh yeah, let's do that song because I want to try to sing that. Oh my God, Mark. He always said, I will give it to Mark. He is not ashamed of going for songs that are like pure song, singer songs, balladeers. Even he's choosing a basically a garage rock song anthem that is one of the hardest ones you can probably pick to sing, and he's just like, oh yeah, I'm totally gonna nail that. I'm totally gonna go for that. What?
At top speed, too.
Oh man. So Black Monk Theme 2 is, it's different. I'm just gonna say it's different and make it easy, because some days I do take that one because I think I do like the conciseness of that. There's something about it. And actually, I honestly do like when the fall use an arpeggiated synth that's like D-d-d-d-d-d-d-d-d-d-d. In any way, I think it's really fitting to their sound, but in this case they just misplaced the tempo of that.
I got a little excited about it.
Got a little excited. Okay, so if y'all like what you're hearing, we're halfway through 1990 and we're having a good time. And not to ruin anything, but I think, not to speak for both of us, but the next two singles on this B side of this episode are some of our favorites and probably better than these first two by exponentially. So if you like what you're hearing, jump on over to Patreon and listen to Side B. And if you're just digging it, just chilling, then we'll see, catch you on the other side, and we'll see you on the next episode, mates. And until next time, we are the fall.
We are the best.